Good morning, church family. Welcome back to our next lesson in our series called Hands-On Faith. This is our third week studying the book of James. So I want to go ahead and hop right in. But let me first remind you that we have Discovery Bible Studies that are walking through this entire series. It's an a 9-week series that you can find that online. You can find that here at the church in bookmark form. We want you to be studying this stuff not only while we're at church, but while you're at home or while you're at work or while you're at the cafeteria table, students. We want you to be able to sit down and ask these awesome questions about Scripture, especially what we're studying here at church. So let's hop into our third lesson of Hands-On Faith. You know, I remember even as a young child wondering, why are certain people treated different? You know, I remember it used to be a thing on TV where you would watch concerts, and I would always love to watch Michael Jackson concerts, mostly because he could moonwalk and do all that cool stuff. I won't try any of that right here, but if you catch me like in my office on a random day, you might see some of it. But I remember watching his concerts, and when he would walk out onto the stage and sometimes kind of through the crowd in a little path that they had set for him, of course, with all of his security, you would see people not only just yelling and screaming and cheering for him, but you would see people like passing out because they got to be in the presence of Michael Jackson. I always thought that was strange. You know, I remember when Bethany and I were first married, we did ministry in Orlando, and there are more people in Orlando, so you'd see people that were kind of famous sometimes. And I remember going to Panera Bread right there in downtown Orlando and walking out, and there was basketball legend Dr. J. And I remember, because he's a legend, I remember my heart beating a little bit faster. Bethany wanted me to get an autograph, but I thought, well, he's eating and he's with his wife. I maybe shouldn't do that. But that still left me with a weird feeling, like, why would I treat him any different or feel any different than I would feel around anybody else? And I remember also going to Chick-fil-A one Wednesday night, because we used to do that every Wednesday night with some of the youth group and their families, and this gigantic man walked in. And he was a guy that not a lot of people know, but he was an Orlando Magic player, Glenn Big Baby Davis. And I remember, I thought, of course, because he was gigantic, and if you haven't met my wife, she is not gigantic, thinking how funny it would be to have a picture of Big Baby Davis with Bethany. And of course, I asked him for a picture, and he gladly took one. But then walking away, I remember thinking, what would be, like, why don't I ask random people for pictures like that? Like, what if I just walked in to Chick-fil-A and there was just a random stranger that wasn't any different, had a regular job or that kind of thing? Why wouldn't I just ask that person for a picture? Why would I ask this guy? And of course, there's this idea of celebrity and all this stuff, and he makes a lot of money. But does that really make him any different? You know, the book of James, it is this whole concept is talked about when James starts to begin talking about showing favoritism. In James chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, here's what he says. He says, "My brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, 'You sit here in a good place,' while you say to the poor man, 'You stand over there,' or 'Sit down at my feet,' have you not then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name by which you were called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself,' you are doing well." Listen, I love how James chapter 2 starts off there when he says, "My brothers, show no partiality or favoritism." In the original language, a lot of the versions bring this out where it says, "Be not a respecter of man or respecter of persons." Saying like, don't show any favoritism based on status or who somebody is. But listen, he says, as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. This is something so, so important for us as followers of Christ to understand, that God is the Lord of glory, that Jesus is King on the throne. He is creator. He is amazing. He is marvelous. He is worthy of praise. And this is why James brings this out, because he wants us to understand that we are not God. Look, we're in one of two positions. Either you are glorious God or you are not glorious man. And within that subsection of not glorious men, there are not a bunch of different things. Like, there's not important people and not important people. There are not people who matter and people who don't. There are not worthy people and unworthy people. We're just all unworthy people, right? We're just all people who don't deserve God's grace. That's why it's a gift that's given to us. We're not anything special. It is only God who is glorious. And so it's so fitting for James to start right there and say, the Lord of glory and the Lord Jesus Christ, showing that he is most important. It has nothing to do with status here on this earth. Here's the truth. Distinctions are from man, and oneness is from God. God created us all in his image, and we are all the same. And yeah, you might be able to look at different people and see different things, but that doesn't mean we are different. That's just a display of God's amazing creativity. But when it comes down to it, we're all the same. We're all people who need Jesus Christ. We're all in the same boat. Nobody is better than anybody else. And that's why James says, look, if a poor man walks in and you say, hey, sit at my feet, but a rich man comes in and you give him the most honorable seat in the house, then you have done a disservice to God's creation. Because distinctions and factions, divisions, all those things are not created by God. They're just created by man. What God created was for us to live in harmony and unity with one another. Listen, in the end of chapter 1, James just got done talking about pure religion. And he said pure religion is this: taking care of the widows and the orphans, and also keeping yourself from being polluted by this world. And we had to remember that when James is writing this, he didn't say, here's chapter 1, here's chapter 2. So these thoughts are following this pure religion talk. Look, if your religion is going to be pure, you will invest in people who can never give anything back to you. I mean, like, isn't that why we form relationships sometimes? We want to reach out to people who we can have a mutually beneficial relationship with. Those are the people that many times we find those people worthy of our time. Why? Because it's not going to be a one-sided thing where I pour out and pour out and pour out, but they're going to be able to give something back to me in this relationship. We deem those relationships productive. But what James is saying here is that we should not show favoritism to anybody. So if somebody can give something back to us, you know, think about it in the church terms. If somebody who comes in and they're in a really nice looking suit and they've got some nice shoes on and they might have a gold watch and gold ring and all this kind of stuff on, we might be guilty, if we're not careful, of saying, let me go talk to that person. Because if they don't know Jesus, I'm going to tell them about Jesus. And then that person can be somebody who contributes in the church, both financially and with their influence and by the ability to work. But if a guy walks in and he is homeless, we may not, if we're not careful, we may not give him the same time of day as we did the rich man. And subconsciously, that may be because we don't think he'd be able to contribute as much as the rich man. But if your religion is pure, you'll invest in people who will never be able to give anything back to you. In James chapter 2, going forward in verse 9, here's what he says. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. If you do not commit adultery but do murder, then you've become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Man, that is a huge statement there by James, that mercy triumphs over judgment. Of course, we love that when it comes to God, right? We love that God would show us mercy. We revel and we celebrate knowing that our God has forgiven our sins, that he is in mercy, in terms of mercy. We deserve punishment from God. We deserve, because of sin, for God to hold us at a distance. Or as we're told in the New Testament, we deserve for God to hold us up as an object of wrath. But in mercy, he doesn't give us what we deserve. He gives us the gift of grace. And we can be like so relaxed in that state from God, but we forget to extend that to other people. Man, what would our lives look like if we allowed mercy to really triumph over judgment when it came to our horizontal relationships here on earth? You know, we love it from God, but why don't we extend it to the people that we love the most? I mean, think about husbands and wives where it's so easy for people, if you're not careful, to hold something against each other. Or if somebody messes up, we don't withhold judgment. We give judgment, but we withhold mercy. But then we expect God to do the opposite for us. Or man, if somebody like cuts us off in traffic, we give judgment. We don't give mercy. And what about the person who walks in and doesn't look like a rich man? Do we give them judgment or do we give them mercy? You know, it's not like they've done something wrong to you, but what is our initial thought towards people? Most people, especially in our culture, do not withhold judgment on people. Well, we say things like, oh, it's natural for us to see somebody and to make a snap judgment. James says, no. You see somebody and you give mercy and you withhold judgment, because if you don't do that, then that's how God's going to interact with you. We have got to get better at seeing people deeper than how they appear. When we only look at how people appear, we are always going to give judgment and we're going to keep mercy for ourselves. James is spurring us on to a life that is totally different than this. Church, we should always lean to the side of mercy. It wins over judgment every single time. Look, if you show partiality, if you and I have the ability to like show favoritism of one person to another, then what James has also told us is that we have become a transgressor of the whole law. We are guilty of all of it. Of course, he used some pretty extreme ones in his writing. He said, look, it's also said, don't commit adultery and don't murder. But if you didn't commit adultery and you do murder, you're still guilty of it all. And that's really extreme cases. Like, I can't think of two sins that I would want to avoid with all of my heart is adultery and murder. Those two things seem like the worst of the worst. I know God sees them differently than I see them. But you talk about something else, like, what about murder? You take a really big one, and then you take showing favoritism. And you say, no, those things are completely different. But what James is telling us in God's word is that if we show favoritism, we still carry the same guilt as if we had committed murder. We're still a transgressor because we have sinned. It's not like it's a smaller thing. So we can't be looking around saying, okay, well, look what this person is doing. I'm just showing favoritism. All I did was show a snap judgment. Of course, that person deserved it because they've made decisions in the past that have caused them to be in this place. And so now this person is not a safe person. I understand that. But I also understand that that person needs mercy, not judgment. Show mercy first. And you might say, look, why should we even do this? Why should we show mercy? Why should we not show favoritism towards people? Let me show you why. Because in Romans chapter 2, beginning of verse 6, here's what we learn about God. It says, he will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace to everyone who does good, the Jew first and also the Greek. For God shows no partiality. Look, for those who do evil, it doesn't matter what background they come from. It doesn't matter how much money they have or what nationality they are, or what color their skin is. They will all receive the due judgment that God has for them. And for those who follow after Jesus, for those who know the gospel of Christ and have committed fully to it, been baptized into Christ and live faithfully for him, it doesn't matter what you look like. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter the color of your skin or what part of the city you live in. Like, God will not show favoritism. He's not going to say, look, you're more influential in local politics, so you get more favor. And he's not going to say, look, you're a guy who lives on the street, so you're not going to have favor. He's not going to look and say, well, we've got a single mom here, and we have a nuclear structured family here, and so they're going to get favor. No. God is not a respecter of persons. God sees souls. And they're either saved or they're not saved. This week, I want to challenge you to do this. I want to challenge you to step outside of the natural bounds that we have in our minds of showing favoritism towards people. You might say, you know, that first section there in James, I can't relate to it. Because when a homeless man comes into church, I'll talk to him. I'll ask him to sit by me. And that is absolutely great. And I love that you do that. And some of you say, I don't talk to anybody. I just come in and I do my own thing and then I leave. And listen, there's some work to do there. But I want to ask you this. You may not be purposefully neglecting somebody who walks into the church, but what about the people that you associate with all during the week? So here's my challenge to you this week. So that you and I can practice this idea of not showing favoritism, will you purposefully sit down with somebody who can offer you nothing in return and listen to their story and show them that your time is not valuable to you, but they are worth your time. That they are so valuable that it's worth you sitting down with them or eating a meal with them, giving your time to listen to their story. Let's be people who actively do not show favoritism. Let's not just sit around and wait for it to the opportunity to present itself here in the church building, but let's go out and show love to people who don't usually show love. You know exactly who I'm talking about. You can picture them in your mind. Students, you can see that person at the end of the lunch table. You can see them walking alone on your school campus. Adults, you can see that person on the street corner, or you can think of that person at your work. Will you show them that they're important? Why? Because that's how God sees them. Let's pray together, and then the lesson will be yours. Our Father in heaven, we love you so much. I am so eternally grateful that you look at me and you don't judge me based on what I have or don't have. You judge me on, am I yours or not? And God, I pray that the way that you see people, I'll be able to do the same. God, that when I walk out of the four walls of my home and the church, I pray, God, that I don't see people and make a judgment. God, I can even think of specific people right now that are so valuable to you, but I have deemed them unworthy of my time, and I repent from that. God, I ask as a congregation, you bless us with the minds to never, ever show favoritism. God, we're mindful that you have chosen. It's really been your model for a long time, that you've chosen the foolish to shame the wise. You've chosen the ones that people thought were uneducated and ordinary men to go and change the world. And for some reason, we want to look for the most influential people to change our communities, and we want to change our minds. God, we know that status means nothing, but souls mean everything. We love you, God. We pray this all in the powerful name of King Jesus. Amen. Love you, Orange Avenue.